and fixer Michael Cohen. The New York Times broke the story. One of Cohen's business partners, a man known as the Taxi King, copping a plea in a state tax evasion case, agreeing to help state and federal prosecutors, which means potentially talking to Team Mueller. Yevgeny Friedman is Michael Cohen's longtime partner in the taxi business. He was accused of failing to pay more than $5 million in taxes and faced four counts of criminal tax fraud and one of grand larceny. The Times, citing a person briefed on the matter, reports that his cooperation will keep him out of prison. This, of course, follows another recent plea deal made with Paul Manafort's former son-in-law, which could turn up the heat on Manafort. More reporting now on this from CNN's Kara Scannell, who joins us from Washington. So what do we know about this deal that Michael Cohen's taxi business partner made?
Well, Anderson, we know that Gene Friedman, who's known as New York's Taxi King, pleaded guilty today to one count of state tax fraud charges. He was facing multiple charges for evading $5 million in taxes in New York State. So today his plea deal is that he is going to plead guilty to this one count for just $50,000 in taxes. So that's a significant reduction in what he could potentially be facing. Also, as part of this plea agreement, he is not going to face any jail time. Now, the New York Times is reporting this is a cooperation agreement, which means he will be he's agreeing to cooperate with New York state and federal authorities about any investigations that they have on going. And Friedman, as you said, was a longtime business partner of Michael Cohen. He managed for him many medallions to run these New York taxi cabs and in Chicago. And so he will know some of Michael Cohen's business operations and dealings. And that is going to be the question of what is going to be of most interest as part of this cooperation agreement.
So, I mean, is this part of a bigger strategy to get Michael Cohen to work with special counsel by having this guy flip on Michael Cohen?
Well, we know that the U.S. Attorney's Office in Manhattan, which is investigating Michael Cohen, started their investigation in part as a referral from Special Counsel Robert Mueller's team. Now, the U.S. Attorney's Office said that they're looking into Michael Cohen's personal financial dealings. And as part of that search warrant that was executed by the FBI last month, they were looking specifically at information relating to Cohen's taxi medallion business and some of his business partners. Now, this is potentially a stepping stone to Mueller's case. But it remains to be seen. You know, the U.S. Attorney's Office has not charged Michael Cohen with any crime. They're investigating him. And Friedman has a knowledge of some of Cohen's tax medallion business. There's no suggestion that Donald Trump was involved in any tax medallion. So I think, you know, it will have to see what Friedman knows about Cohen beyond the medallion business and if there's anything at all. But it will put pressure on Michael Cohen as he's facing this investigation. And if Friedman does know something about him, that will put pressure on him and it will inform the U.S. Attorney's Office, which is investigating him, and ultimately leads to, you know, potentially help this decision of whether they think there is a case and they bring charges against him or if they don't, Anderson.
Yeah, Kara Scannell, appreciate it. Now more breaking news. New CNN reporting about efforts to sharply limit the scope of questioning when and if President Trump sits down with Robert Mueller. CNN chief political analyst Gloria Borger shares the byline on this story. She joins us now. So what have you learned, Gloria?
Well, Anderson, my colleagues Evan Perez, Dana Bash, and I have learned that the president's legal team is trying to narrow the scope of any potential interview with the special counsel to Russia-related matters that occurred before Trump's election. Now, our sources are telling us that in trying to avoid a standoff, one possibility they're thinking about is this limited Trump interview, plus they're offering written answers to questions regarding the issue of obstruction, which we all know is an issue that the special counsel is clearly very interested in. And they're also insisting that if there is an interview, they want an audio recording with the president, so there is absolutely no question about what was said.
Is there any indication that Mueller would actually agree to these terms?
No, there isn't. I mean, we've been cautioned by a couple of sources that particularly regarding written answers to questions about obstruction, Mueller has suggested that this is not something he could live with. And so we don't know, Anderson, whether if they can't reach any agreement, and one source said to me, you know, we're inching towards something, hopefully, but if they are not, this could wind up in the Supreme Court. And these kinds of proposals gives, you know, the Trump attorneys cover to say, look, we tried and we tried and we tried, but we couldn't reach any kind of conclusion here.
It does seem like we've heard a lot more about these interview negotiations since Rudy Giuliani joined the president's legal team. I mean, I know obviously you're not going to talk about who your sources are.
Sure.
But it certainly seems like, I mean, is Giuliani the one driving all of these stories, or at least in recent weeks, it certainly seems like it.
Well, you know, Rudy Giuliani, first of all, has only met with the special counsel once, and I think his prime purpose right now is to kind of speak to one person, and that's the President of the United States, who has been very happy when Giuliani punches back for him. You know, this legal team hasn't had a real spokesman out there. But in terms of doing sort of real negotiating at this point, I think that's up to a lot of the other lawyers involved. And Giuliani seems to me to be functioning as a spokesman and kind of weighing in once in a while and presenting the president's point of view to the American public, which they really haven't had in the past.
Yeah, Gloria, thanks very much. Speaking of Rudy Giuliani, joining us now with her own reporting, new reporting is Maggie Haberman, also Paul Callan, Michael Zeldin, and Carrie Cordero. So Maggie, I understand you talked to Giuliani today. What did he tell you about this timeline?
So he called me because Mike Schmidt and I, my colleague, had reported on Sunday that he had said that the special counsel had told the legal team they hoped to have this wrapped by September 1st, but they made clear it was contingent on an interview with the president. That's all that this negotiation is all about, and that these meetings have been about. He called because there had been reports that he might have made that up. I think there's been a lot of suggestion about that after a Reuters report, and he said everybody in the room on their legal team, you know, who came in with them, heard it the same way, except for Jay Sekulow, who was one of the president's other lawyers, who heard it as end of summer, which technically end of summer is, I think, September 22nd mm-hmm. this year. But regardless, that it was roughly the same time frame. And his point was they have heard from Mueller's office in the past when Mueller's folks have been unhappy with something that the team has done, that Trump's team have done. They did not say anything this time, and he just wanted to articulate that.
Carrie Cordero, I mean, is there any planet on which Robert Mueller would agree to not ask the president about possible obstruction of justice, about things, you know, that happened after he took office?
You know, listening to the reporting just now, I think there's a possibility that what they are trying to float publicly is actually what the president is willing to be interviewed on. So not so much what the special counsel would limit the questions, but maybe this is what, and I'm sort of extrapolating here, maybe this is what the Trump team is willing to be interviewed on, and what they're suggesting is that anything beyond these particular topics, they would say the president is not going to answer those questions, and so then what they're doing is they would be forcing the special counsel's hand to issue a subpoena.
Paul Callan, I mean, it is no coincidence that all these, you know, leaks or even public statements from Rudy Giuliani, I mean, it seems like it's all coming from the president's legal team. To Carrie's point, it does seem like they're trying to play this out in the court of public opinion.
Yeah, they are. And of course, Giuliani, having been both a politician and a U.S. attorney, is kind of adept at using the criminal justice system and politics together in a way maybe that other lawyers don't. And I think Giuliani understands that a president would be expected to give testimony. The American public would certainly expect it. They wouldn't expect him to take the Fifth Amendment. So he's trying to present the case that the president wants to talk and wants to answer reasonable questions, and that it's unreasonable for Mueller to not accept these terms.
Michael Zeldin, I mean, you work for Robert Mueller. Do you think he appreciates Rudy Giuliani and I guess others in the president's orbit, if that's who's floating these timeline stories in the press? I mean, is he the kind of investigator that's susceptible to pressure like that?
I don't think he's susceptible to pressure. I don't think he appreciates these disclosures. I think that what is going on is that the real lawyers who are representing the president are negotiating with Mueller's team about the terms of an interview. And I think those are very complicated and sensitive negotiations. And I think that both sides want it to remain that way. But then you have, you know, the likes of Giuliani sort of blabbing, I don't know how else to describe it, Anderson, to the press about, you know, his ruminations. And I don't think it furthers the interests of his client, and I don't think he's really attuned to what's going on in the nitty-gritty of the conversations between the real lawyers and Mueller's representatives.
Carrie, I mean, Giuliani has argued that the president can't be subpoenaed because Mueller, again, according to Giuliani, has agreed to abide by past DOJ precedent, which is that a sitting president can't be indicted. Can't the president simply be subpoenaed as a witness?
So he could be subpoenaed. And I think that the legal team has made pretty clear at this point, Rudy Giuliani, that if he is subpoenaed, that they will challenge it. And so they would have the opportunity to do that. It could go all the way through the courts, and it could really drag things on. So I do think that that is part of their strategy. There are arguments for that I think the special counsel has. For example, one argument that has traditionally been levied against a president being able to participate in criminal proceedings is that it takes away from presidential duties. I would think that a new legal analysis would need to be conducted as it pertains to this specific president, because he occupies the presidency and executes his daily schedule in a very different way than we've seen prior presidents, with his executive time, with a lot of time on the golf course. And so the argument that prior administrations have made that the president can't devote any time and it would take away from his exercise of his duties, I think that's one fact that they would have to overcome.
So may I add one thing to that, Anderson, which is I think that there is a clear distinction between indictment, trial, and incarceration on one hand, which is what I think the OLC opinion addresses, and then the judicial process to obtain evidence, a grand jury subpoena or otherwise. I don't think the OLC opinion is as clear on that front end about can the president resist giving testimony as it is clear on the indictment, trial, and incarceration period. And I think that the sides, again, the real lawyers representing the president and Mueller's team are discussing what does the term criminal process mean in those OLC opinions. Does it encompass testimony or just the indictment, trial,
but,
and
you know, Michael,
incarceration?
I just wanted to add, I wouldn't rule out, though, in the end, Mueller cutting a deal with the president to get some kind of statement, written or audio, from the president. And I say that because ultimately Trump has nothing but contempt for the judiciary and for the judicial system and the criminal justice system. And I can see him taking the Fifth Amendment ultimately if a subpoena is served, which means in the end, Mueller gets no information. And my experience as a prosecutor has been prosecutors would rather take some information from a potential defendant in a case than get nothing at all. So we'll have to see how this wraps
it's
up.
It's interesting, Maggie, because I mean, Michael Zeldin is referring to, you know, the other lawyers on the president's team as the real lawyers, Rudy Giuliani more sort of the public face of the team.
It's both true and not true. I mean, it is true that there are other lawyers, particularly the Raskins, who were hired along with Rudy Giuliani. The president wanted Rudy Giuliani out there because he kept saying to people, nobody knows who the Raskins are, and I want somebody with a big name. So he has Giuliani out there as to make a splash, but he does have Rudy Giuliani out there to be pushing their case. I mean, Kerry is absolutely right. What he is doing is he is out there pushing a position, and that position is largely setting up an argument by which if they force Mueller to subpoena the president, that is going to be the route that they take. And I think that they are taking a gamble that even that might not happen. I don't think that anybody I talk to, and I've said this here before, anybody I talk to around the president says nobody except occasionally the president wants the president to do this interview. They are basically running out the clock as much as possible.
Gloria, I know you wanted to add something.
I think that this is kind of a legal game of chicken in a way, because I think the Trump team is gambling that Mueller perhaps wants to avert this fight, this extended fight that would take this case to the Supreme Court. And, you know, there are some on that team I've talked to who say, look, we just don't think he wants to do it. If he does want to do it, we are, you know, we are happy to go there, and we will. But they're trying to put as much on the table to show that they're negotiating in good faith in case it does end up in the courts, and they can say, look, you know, we tried.
Yeah.
We failed, but we tried.
I got to take a quick break. We're going to pick up the conversation next. And later, keep in mind about all the talk of spies and infiltration coming out of Washington, including from the president himself.
This is a tomato you can track from farm to pot.
Agreeing to cooperate with state and federal prosecutors, back now with the panel. Maggie, is it clear, I mean, the implications of this or how big a development this is regarding Michael Cohen?
It's not clear, and it's actually, I mean, look, obviously anybody who's got some kind of a business entanglement with Michael Cohen, it's going to become of interest. I'm assuming that we and others are hearing that there is some implication that whatever deal was cut, that that's what it is. I got a statement unsolicited from Evgeny saying this, saying
this is the guy who was indicted.
Who pleaded guilty. Yeah. He said, I plead guilty to a felony. I'm humbled and shamed. This is me taking responsibility for my actions. Michael is a dear, dear personal friend and a passive client. That's it. This is a very difficult day for myself and my family. Look, I don't know that he would know everything about Michael Cohen's businesses. It sounds like he managed some of Michael Cohen's medallions, or he was a management company. But I do think that it is very likely prosecutors are using him to try to add pressure to Michael Cohen to make some move of his own in terms of talking about Donald Trump.
Yeah, Paul, I mean, just given what you know about the legal system here in New York, I mean, he was accused of failing to pay more than $5 million in taxes. He faced four counts of criminal tax fraud, one of grand larceny. Each had a maximum prison sentence of up to 25 years. I assume if he gets this deal, he gets a deal where he's not going to be facing any prison time, and I think it was only like a $50,000 fine or pleading guilty to $50,000. What kind of a deal would he have to, what kind of information would he have in order to get that deal? Is that an unusual deal?
Yeah, that is an unusual deal, facing that much jail time and that much of a fine. So I would say he's trading something substantial. But the question is it something substantial about Cohen that would lead back to the president? Or it could also, you know, there have been ongoing investigations of the taxi industry. The medallion industry in New York is always under investigation. It could be a lot of information about that. And I think the other thing you have to consider also is that Mueller was very careful about passing off the Cohen case to the U.S. attorney for the Southern District of New York, because it at least appeared to be unrelated to the Russia investigation. Now, this is something that spins off of the Cohen investigation. So this could turn out to be a New York thing primarily, rather than the path back to the Trump administration.
Kerry, I mean, this is a state plea deal for Friedman, aka the taxi king, as the Times is reporting. But he could, I mean, to Paul's point, he could assist federal prosecutors as well.
He could, although I have to agree that I am tending to be a little bit cautious based on what we know so far before drawing too straight of a line between this plea agreement and potential implications for the president and the overall Russia investigation. So
do you think it has potential implications for Michael Cohen? I mean,
I certainly think it has implications for Michael Cohen as a business deal. I think it's important that we recognize that there is a piece of the investigation concerning Michael Cohen that really is only about his business dealings and this taxi or whatever other financial stuff he was into in New York. And there is some piece of this investigation that is only about that. Now, does Michael Cohen know other things about Trump organization, financial dealings, or just his other interactions with the president and the campaign team over the course of the campaign? Sure. So could the, I'm not saying that there couldn't eventually be leverage that is placed on Michael Cohen that would affect those larger investigations. But I just do think it's important
to
point out that there's a piece that only pertains to Michael Cohen's business dealings.
Michael, do you agree with that? I mean, there's also, you know, to those of the president's allies who say the Southern District of New York investigation into Cohen is a convenient way to investigate things beyond Mueller's mandate that may somehow implicate the president.
Well, I think there's no factual predicate for that. I agree with Kerry and Paul both that this plea agreement is a plea agreement that's directed at Michael Cohen and his businesses, particularly perhaps his targeted medallion taxi business. Beyond that is really too speculative to know whether or not it reaches the president or anything else. But we do know that the cooperation agreement is for him to cooperate with state and federal prosecutors. And so clearly the Southern District wants cooperation with respect to their inquiry, which is Cohen specific. And then we'll just have to see, Anderson, as time progresses, whether Cohen cooperates. And if he does cooperate, what does he have, if anything, to cooperate with respect to? We just don't know that, and we have to be very careful not to go down that path. Yeah.
Thanks, everybody. Coming up next, one of three people approached by the confidential FBI source the president and others are suggesting or flat out saying may have been a spy in the campaign. Carter Page joins us. And the latest on the extraordinary images and real danger from lava bombs in Hawaii coming up tonight.
There's nothing small about your business. With Dell Small Business Technology Advisors, you'll get the one-on-one partnership you need.
Former Trump campaign foreign policy advisor Carter Page joins us in a few moments. By the time a confidential FBI source contacted him in July of 2016, presumably to assess his ties, if any, to Russian intelligence, he'd been on the FBI's radar for quite some time. As you know, in 2013, audio surveillance picked up suspected Russian spies discussing attempts to recruit someone identified in the court filing only as male number one. Mr. Page subsequently confirmed to BuzzFeed News that he was male number one, but said his contacts with the Russians in question did not include any sensitive matters and had no idea that they may have worked for an intelligence service. A short time after this, FBI source got in touch with him in 2016. The Justice Department persuaded a Foreign Intelligence Surveillance, or FISA court, that there was probable cause to think he was acting as an agent of Russia. Mr. Page, we should say, has yet to be charged with any crime, and he absolutely categorically denies any wrongdoing. Those are the facts that we know. Now, it's important to state the facts up front because they seem to be islands these days in a sea of non-facts or alternative facts or unfounded claims and red herrings where the Russian investigation is concerned. These days, lifelong law enforcement and counterintelligence professionals are painted as agents of a dark conspiracy or deep state agents or the political opposition or all those things rolled into one. Today, sitting next to the president of one of the world's younger democracies, South Korea, the president of the world's oldest democracy, did just that, once again raising the specter of spies in his campaign.
If they had spies in my campaign, that would be a disgrace to this country. That would be one of the biggest insults that anyone's ever seen, and it would be very illegal, aside from everything else. It would make probably every political event ever look like small potatoes.
Well, you may not have noticed it, but the president used a very small fig leaf in that first sentence, the word if, to cover a very loaded word, spies. In his view, the reported approaches to Carter Page, George Papadopoulos, and campaign official Sam Clovis were not acts of counter-espionage against the Russians. They were acts of espionage by the government spying on his campaign. Now, the president refused to answer a later question today about the deputy attorney general overseeing the Russia probe.
Do you have confidence in Rod Rosenstein?
What's your next question, please?
I'm a reporter from...
No, excuse me. I have the president of South Korea here.
Yes.
Okay.
I have a question.
He doesn't want to hear these questions, if you don't mind.
So, did the president simply not want to offend his guests, or was he done talking about Russia because he'd already made his point? He'd already said the word spies. In just the last week or so, he's tweeted, if the FBI or DOJ was infiltrating a campaign for the benefit of another campaign, that is a really big deal. He quoted Fox News, saying apparently the DOJ put a spy in the Trump campaign. He tweeted a headline, wow, word seems to be coming out that the Obama FBI spied on the Trump campaign with an embedded informant. And of course, on Sunday, he tweeted, I hereby demand and will do so officially tomorrow that the Department of Justice look into whether or not the FBI, DOJ infiltrated or surveilled the Trump campaign for political purposes. Infiltration, spy, spy, spying. And if you think for a minute that the choice of words is accidental or incidental, listen to how many others have been using the same talking points.
Major developments again tonight on the deep state spying on the Trump campaign.
Possibly paid informants to spy on the Trump campaign.
May indicate that the Obama administration did, in fact, spy on the Trump campaign.
The spying they did on the Trump campaign.
I'm shocked to hear that they put a spy in the campaign.
FBI spies.
Or maybe two spies.
These spy revelations.
To spy on the Republican candidate for president.
If there's a spy, they got nothing from it.
If they ran a spy ring, that is an absolute red line.
Now, from one spy to two spies to a spy ring, that's Devin Nunes, of course, the chairman of the House Intelligence Committee, who presumably should be familiar with real spy rings as well as how real counterintelligence investigations work. And just to refresh everyone's memory, the way they work is the way things apparently played out with Mr. Page, George Papadopoulos, Sam Clovis, and perhaps others. According to our own reporting and others, this confidential source was not someone embedded in the campaign to spy on it. He was asked to try and glean information from several persons, one of whom, George Papadopoulos, had already reportedly boasted about being offered Russian access to Hillary Clinton's emails. Now, this was happening shortly after Donald Trump Jr. and other top members of the Trump campaign met Russians at Trump Tower in hopes of getting their help in beating Hillary Clinton. This was happening in the middle of an operation the U.S. intelligence community would warn the Trump campaign about in the summer of 2016, according to NBC News, and later conclude, reading from their report, we assess Russian President Vladimir Putin ordered an influence campaign in 2016 aimed at the U.S. presidential election. Russia's goals were to undermine public faith in the U.S. democratic process, denigrate Secretary Clinton, and harm her electability and potential presidency. We further assess Putin and the Russian government developed a clear preference for President-elect Trump. We have high confidence in these judgments. One of the people who met with this FBI confidential source was Carter Page, and I'm pleased that he joins me now. Thanks so much for being back with us. Appreciate it.
Great to be with you, Anderson. Obviously,
there's a lot you probably can't say. Do you remember when you first came into contact with this confidential informant?
Yeah, I was attending an academic conference at Cambridge University. Madeleine Albright was there, mm-hmm. a lot of other senior people from the Clinton campaign.
This was in the summer?
July 2016, okay.
Yes. So was that after you had been to Russia or before? Because you'd also been to a similar, to make a speech at a university there.
Exactly.
So it was the week after you'd been to Russia.
Yep.
Okay. And how did, I mean, was there anything unusual about your conversations with this guy?
I never found anything unusual whatsoever. You know, and there's a lot of allegations out there right now.
Was that the first time you'd met him? As far as you remember?
Absolutely. Yeah.
And so, of course, we're not saying his name. We're not reporting on his name. He's an academic. Was he direct with you? I mean, did he try to befriend you, take you out to lunch or dinner, and then chat you up, trying to talk about Russia?
Well, I mean, it was a long, two-and-a-half-day conference. Mm-hmm. And so basically from morning till late at night, we were at various, you know, debates, conversations about foreign policy and politics. So.
And then how much did you stay in contact with him after that?
We ended up staying in contact for over a year. Mm-hmm. So, you know, but it's someone you typically meet people in.
And the contact for over the year, was it by email? Did you see him again?
We met up several times, yeah.
Did he ask you to come back to England to meet up to discuss
things? No, I never. That was the only time I ever met him in England. So it was always inside the Beltway.
And did he ever ask you for documents about the campaign or anything like that?
We always, you know, we would talk about various things that are happening. And, you know, he's someone who is, you know, long-term, someone who'd been in part of the establishment in Republican politics.
Right.
So typically, you know, around the convention time and the halfway through a presidential year, you keep bringing on more people in terms of potential supporters from the party, et cetera. And it just seemed like something like that. So,
but did he ever, the implication that he's a spy spying that campaign, if someone was a spy spying that campaign, I would think they would want internal campaign documents that you might pass along, or, you know, memos or anything that would give them a view into the campaign itself. Did he ever ask you for anything like that?
We had open conversations, so it's a little bit difficult for me to sort of ascertain
him any documents from the campaign.
I not that I can recall. There really weren't too many documents. Again,
right.
We were part of a informal campaign volunteer committee, so
right.
It's pretty.
You tweeted about this guy. You said he never seemed suspicious. Just a few scholars exchanging ideas. He had interest in policy and politics. I mean, the president has repeatedly seemed to indicate he's a spy infiltrating the campaign. That doesn't sound like a spy infiltrating the campaign from your description there. Is that fair to say?
Well, having been through what I've been through in terms of the defamation by, you know, major media outlets in September.
You have a suit against.
Both the U.S. government. I mean, I have two co-defendants. One is the U.S. government or the Broadcasting Board of Governors, which underwrote this.
You've also accused the Clinton campaign of human rights abuses, going after you because you're a man and because you're a Christian or Catholic, I believe, or something.
Well, look, I mean, what is well-founded, and again, it's their lawyers from Perkins Coie that have admitted to this. Things we were talking about last March when we were having our conversation, you know, a lot keeps being proven true,
right.
And it only gets worse.
Was,
you know,
originally hired
by
Republicans, but you're right, then it was Democrats. I'm wondering, you know, do you believe that the president is using this basically to try to weaken the Mueller investigation?
I see no connection with it. You know, he always said we're looking out for the forgotten man. And, you know, I've always been looking to just kind of get justice in terms of what's been going on. And to the extent that we kind of get some real information out there as to some of the abuses. And increasingly, there's been a lot of evidence that's come out, particularly in early February when the House Intelligence, both the Democrats and the Republicans, their memos continue to show that there's a lot of wrongdoing related to this.
What are you saying is wrongdoing here, though?
Well, look, abuse of process, you know, in terms of the FISA court. And, in this lawsuit, Department of Justice, if you're suing the U.S. government, represents the federal agency. And they pleaded that, you know, there was no, you know, part of the sovereign immunity, there's a caveat that you can then hold them accountable.
Well, I mean, it's not just an individual who, like, you know, I mean, a judge did sign off on a search warrant, and the bar is pretty high for a FISA warrant.
Well, and this is sort of the challenge I'm having because, you know, Department of Justice gives this false information related to, you know, there's no abuse of process. So, and that's exactly what they were pleading in my case. And then 2 days later, this is a pleading in late January, 2 days later on February 2nd, a lot of evidence comes out showing that's exactly what happened.
But just finally, just on this confidential informant, do you believe he was a spy infiltrating the Trump campaign, or based on your interactions, were most of your discussions about Russia?
No, we were talking about all sorts of, you know, foreign policy. Again, we're two scholars.
So you saw him. Do you believe he is a spy who was trying to infiltrate the campaign?
We'll see. I mean, there's increasingly, you know, there's this drip, 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 where there's a lot of information that keeps coming out.
There's a lot of allegations, but you're one of the few people who's actually, you know, met this guy, talked to this guy. So I'm wondering, as you see it now, maybe more information will come out, but as you see it now, did you get a sense, as you look back, this is a guy who's trying to weasel into the Trump campaign and get internal documents stuff, or, I mean, if you remember any of your conversations, was it focused more on Russia and any of your interactions you may have had?
I've been shocked with some of the abuses that have happened, you know, which I've learned about ex post facto.
So you won't give your opinion one way or the other?
I don't like to make accusations without hard facts. And,
right. But based on your personal experience, do you have a feeling?
You know, I don't like jumping to conclusions.
Okay,
you know,
fair enough. So. Carter Page, appreciate you joining us. The incoming president of the NRA says a culture of violence is partly to blame for school shootings in the United States, being the disease.
And the disease in this case isn't the Second Amendment. The disease is youngsters who are steeped in a culture of violence. They've been drugged in many cases. Nearly all of these perpetrators are male, and they're young teenagers in most cases. And they've come through a culture where violence is commonplace. All we need to do is turn on a TV, go to a movie.
Male teenagers steeped in a culture of violence. He mentions TV and movies, but you may have noticed that he didn't mention the usual suspect when this argument comes up, which is video games. Both Republicans and Democrats have at times wondered if all the violent video games are having some effect on young minds. President Trump brought it up after the Parkland shooting. So why do you think that Oliver North made no mention of violent video games? Well, keeping them honest, perhaps this video from 2012 can provide an answer.
Call of Duty Black Ops 2, a great opportunity for me to be a consultant on the script, as it were, the story plot, work with some remarkable young developers of this story, and obviously one of the greatest entertainment media in the world. I mean, there are more people playing those things at any one time than all of the other entertainment medias you'd ever want to see around the world.
So Oliver North was a consultant on what's considered one of the most violent and popular games out there, Call of Duty. Not only was he a consultant, he appeared in a video hyping the version of the game on which he consulted.
I don't think the average American grasps how violent war is about to become. There is no longer a defined battle space. The enemy could be anywhere, and it could be anyone.
Well, not only did Oliver North appear in that video, he actually shows up in the game itself, a younger, fictionalized, animated version of himself. But there he is, Oliver North, in Call of Duty Black Ops 2. Now, you can debate what effect, if any, video games have on kids. Maybe you believe video games are part of the problem or just harmless fun. We aren't taking a position on either of those options. But we think it entirely fair to point out the glaring hypocrisy of Mr. North, a paid consultant, pitchman, and character in a violent video game, probably doesn't have that much authority to be lamenting the culture of violence that boys are exposed to, or at the very least, if he is so concerned about violence on TV and in movies, he might want to admit he profited from that violence. We invited Oliver North to be on the program. He declined. Just before air, I spoke with Senator Bernie Sanders. Senator Sanders, these comments from Oliver North about the culture of violence, it's pretty hypocritical given that he was, you know, he did a lot of work for one of the most violent video games out there.
Yeah, it is. It's a little bit absurd. I mean, the truth is, I got to tell you, I am not a great fan of these very violent video games. I don't think it's a good idea to have small kids young children be shooting down people in video games. But yes, there is an element of strong hypocrisy if Mr. North was involved in video games and now is condemning them.
You also look at all the other things that Oliver North listed. He talked about the, you know, teenagers are doped up on Ritalin, that they're overprescribed Ritalin. He blames television. He's blaming movies. The one thing, all of which, you know, there may be some validity in each individual things he says, but the one thing he's not pointing the finger at all is access to guns.
Right. And let us be clear that right now in this country, we have 300 million guns floating around, including an estimated 5 million semi-automatic weapons. And let's also be clear that, very sadly, we have a lot of people who are dealing with mental crises today. Last year, we lost over 40,000 people to suicides, and people are in many cases in desperate shape. What we need to do, and this is where, Anderson, the good news is, the American people, gun owners, non-gun owners, are united in saying we need common sense gun safety legislation. And that means expanding background checks to make sure that people who should not own guns, people who are criminals, people who have a series, a history of domestic violence, people who should not own guns should not be able to get guns. Almost everybody in America agrees with that. People agree that we should eliminate the gun show loopholes where people are able to avoid background checks. People agree we should end the straw man provision that allows people to buy guns legally and then sell them illegally. There are a lot of things that have overwhelming support among the American people to go forward with keeping guns out of the hands of people who should not have them. The obstacle there is, in fact, the organization that Mr. North represents, the NRA. And yeah. I would hope very much that the Congress finally has the guts to do what the American people want and does not continue to be intimidated by the NRA.
It's so interesting, though. I mean, you did have, you know, President Trump in the wake of the Parkland shooting sort of taunting Republicans, saying, oh, you know, you're scared of the NRA, doing it to their faces. And even after, you know, last Friday, after the shooting in Santa Fe, said that his administration is determined to do everything in its power to protect students and secure schools. It you know, he spoke one thing after Parkland and then met privately with the NRA, and then he spoke, you know, publicly to an NRA convention. Do you take the president at his word at all that he's...
No, I don't. Look, I don't mean to be hyper-political here, but I think one of the tragedies of the Trump administration is that fewer and fewer people believe anything that he says. You're right. After the Parkland crisis, he brought members of Congress in together. What are we going to do? And I will support this. You bring me the legislation, I'll sign it. Then the NRA comes in and his views completely change. So the truth is, and I say this with no joy in my heart, that whatever he says on Monday doesn't necessarily mean anything on Tuesday. There is no evidence to believe that he will stand up to the NRA, despite the fact that the overwhelming majority of Americans, gun owners, non-gun owners, want to see real action.
I also want to ask you about what's going on with this confidential source, the IG investigation. Do you believe this is anything other than a diversionary tactic by the president and his allies, and a tactic to basically weaken the investigation into?
No, that's what I believe it is. You know, the American people believe, whether you're Republicans, Democrat, Independent, that it should be our voters, the people of this country, who determine the outcome of elections, not Russians, not people from any other country. And what Mueller is trying to do is run. And this is a guy, let's not forget, this is a guy who was widely supported by Democrats and Republicans when he was FBI director, a man widely respected. So instead of cooperating with this investigation to allow it to go its course, what Trump is trying to do is deflect attention from the investigation and go after those people who are trying to secure the truth. Let this investigation play out. I've been asked a million times, do I think Trump should be impeached, blah, blah, blah. I don't right now. Let the investigation play out. Let the truth come out and leave Mueller and his team alone so they can pursue this investigation.
Let me ask you, though, if the tables were turned and you found out that a person who was on the periphery of your campaign for president had said something and that had gotten the attention of the FBI, and they sent a confidential source to interview that person. Would you have a problem with that?
Well, I think what is interesting about this, you know, is Trump is trying to make this into a political job. To the best of my knowledge, the FBI did its best to keep their investigation quiet during the election. So if there was a political effort to undermine any candidate, me, Trump, anybody else, they would have said, they would have leaked something. That is not what happened. They believed, as I understand it, that there was reason to investigate the possibility of collusion. That's what they were doing.
Senator Sanders, I appreciate your time. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Well, 17 months into the Trump administration, there certainly is one constant, which is Twitter. No question that President Trump has posted thousands of tweets. The question is, were they all written by him or by staffers? Coming up, Randy Kaye with what may be some of the answers. Also, all that lava, there's a live picture there right now threatening a power plant in Hawaii. We'll take you to the Big Island coming up. President Trump has posted thousands of tweets since his inauguration, and the White House considers them official statements. But the Boston Globe reports that some of those tweets, even the ones with misspellings or unusual use of capital letters or sentence fragments, may in fact be the work of White House staffers. Randy Kaye tonight has more.
On March 21st, President Donald Trump tweeted, "Special counsel is told to find crimes, whether crimes exist or not. Notice the spelling mistakes? Both counsel and weather are misspelled." One of many tweets from this president riddled with errors, but it might not be from the president at all. His staff is now in on the act, sending tweets under his name.
The staff intends to use poor grammar and intends to just use, you know, sentence fragments and will capitalize random nouns. It's sort of like Ben Franklin style of writing.
You heard that right. Annie Linsky is chief national correspondent for the Boston Globe. She's spoken with sources who tell her oftentimes it is White House staff tapping out the president's thoughts, and the president himself is signing off on their mistakes.
The staff is just getting better at mimicking the style. It's becoming a little bit less clear who is who. I was talking to one person, and he said he couldn't necessarily tell if a tweet was written by the president or by a staff member in his style.
Thank you very much.
If there is one giveaway, the tweet is actually from the president himself. It's spelling, or more specifically, misspelling. Like spelling his wife's name Melanie instead of Melania, or the still mysterious Covfefe. Those, apparently, are all likely President Trump.
The capitalization and the use of fragments and the really unusual punctuation where, a clear question will end with a period or an exclamation point instead of a question mark, those are elements that the staff will mimic. So those are not clear tells. The spelling is the clearest tell.
Dave Robinson is a data scientist and a reporter with The Atlantic magazine. He's developed a Twitter bot called Trump or Not that somehow estimates the likelihood of whether or not Trump wrote a tweet himself.
His language is much angrier. He's likely to use language like crazy, badly, loser. His crazy early morning tweet storms, his angry tweets, those show the real signatures of being from Trump.
This somewhat bland tweet from Trump's Twitter account congratulating his new CIA director was found by the tweet bot to have just a 15% chance of being written by the president himself. But this tweet from last month, using words like witch hunt and fake news, along with two exclamation points, has an 87% chance of having been written directly by the president. So next time you think Donald Trump is sitting in the Oval Office typing out a tweet to you, think again. Randy Kaye, CNN, New York.
We've got a lot more ahead on this busy Tuesday night, including the breaking news that attorneys for President Trump are trying to narrow the scope of any presidential interview by Special Counsel Mueller to actions before he was elected. In other words, no face-to-face.